Today's topic is one special concept in covering space theory, which is again very classical. We are only touching just the definition and a few simple examples. Even the definition may vary from author to author. Okay, so this part we are doing just by examples, not much deeper study of this. The simplest model is when you are studying subgroups of a group, the coset representation helps you a lot. This is the kind of thing that we want to do in topology also, when a group is acting on a topological space. However, the analogy stops there. We have to bring in more topology than choosing and arbitrarily picking up some coset representatives. Okay? So let me stop making comments. Let us first go through the definition and then see whether a few things make sense. Start with a group G acting on a connected topological space. Let me just take for the definiteness that the action is on the right. Then a connected subset D of X is called a fundamental domain if the following happens, namely X is union of all the translates of D. D is the subset of X. You take all right translates of D, G in G, that must be covering the whole of X. This is similar to the choice of right cosets, but there is no disjointness here yet. It's only union. The second part brings a little bit of disjointness, namely for any X in the interior of D, XG is in D implies G must be identity. In other words, the translates of interior of D, they are disjoint. Okay. The third point is that if you restrict the entire map, the quotient map from X to X by G, restrict it to the domain D, that itself must be a quotient map. So now you can see what is the idea. The idea is to cut down the top space X, okay, to something manageable, something smaller. All right. If we insist on coset representations like they are all disjoint, that is not possible because X itself is connected. And that is not desirable also. So we allow minimal overlapping. Namely, in the interior, there should not be any overlapping. So the boundary, there can be overlapping. And that happens. The important thing is that since X is connected, we insist that D is connected. So now I want to tell you that the definitions may slightly vary. For example, if X is X by G is compact, then you may want to choose D to be compact. Secondly, there is no uniqueness in the choice of D. Each person, depending upon the problem at hand, whatever you want to study, you may choose the fundamental domain differently. Okay. So let us just study a few examples how it helps to understand the quotient space and the action of x on action of g on x. So here is the picture which shows that if x is in the boundary, it translates maybe also in the boundary. Maybe. If y is in the interior, then its translate will not be in the interior. It will not even intersect D. This is D, it will be outside of D. This should happen for all G not equal to identity. So that is the, this is the picture, that's all. Okay. So I have already told you condition one above tells us that the quotient map is surjective because translates of this D cover the whole of X. So there is a representative, it's like a cosine representative. Condition two tells you that D to X by G is injective in the interior. Okay. And the condition three says that it's actually a quotient map if you take the whole thing. All right. So let us take an example, the simplest example. All these examples are more or less familiar to you. The first example is the exponential function from R to S1, given by the action of the integers on R by translation. R is a subgroup of, Z is a subgroup of R. So it is like a coset representatives. Okay. So what you want to do is, you can take any closed interval, which we have been doing that, any closed interval of length one, then in the interior, there will not be any identification. When you translate any interior point, it will go outside the interval of length one. But the boundary for a zero will go to, when you add one, it will go to one. So that is the only point of intersection between the translates of the interval, closed interval, and itself. Okay, either way, either you add or subtract, only one of them that intersects. After that, there are no intersections at all. This interval, closed interval, this happens to be connected. That justifies the domain, the word domain here. So it's called a fundamental domain. But in this particular case, it's also compact. Okay, we didn't bargain for that compactness, but because the quotient space, which is the circle, is compact, this was possible. Obviously, it's a fundamental domain itself is compact. The quotient, which is a image of that, will have to be compact. Okay, this is actually was this remark was used in proving that the projective space is compact. Let us come to that example, then I will explain it again. Okay. So here is a comment, says that most of the very interesting examples come similar to this Z contained inside R. Namely, what are called as Lie groups. And then inside that Lie group, you are taking a discrete subgroup. Okay, when you take discrete subgroup inside a Lie group, the quotient becomes a covering space projection. And then you can talk about choosing a fundamental domain there. Okay, to study what is happening to the action as well as the quotient space and so on. All right, so this is the prototype of that example. Since we have not studied or we are not assuming any knowledge of the Lie groups and so on, we cannot pursue that angle more than that. But we can take another simple example, simpler than the exponential function, namely from S1 to S1 or C star to C star or C star to C star itself. Okay, C star to C star, namely Z going to zeta z, where zeta is a primitive nth roots of unity. If this nth root of, if n is 2, then this is just an antipodal action. If n is 3, you are multiplying by omega, omega square, and so on. So this is a group of order 3. Right? We have studied on S1 itself. You can take the primitive n through to affinity. What you get as a quotient space is again S1. Same thing happens in C star also. The polar coordinate representative, the norm of the vector does not get affected because zeta is of unit vector, is of unit length. Okay, so what will be the fundamental domain for C star? You will have to choose a sector. Sector, take any line, say for example, the positive real axis, and then take another line passing through origin, which makes an angle 2 pi by n. And everything lying in between, that's called a sector. All theta between 0 to, e power 2 pi I theta, where theta is between 0 to 2 pi by n. So that forms a fundamental domain. In the interior, there will not be any identification. But on the boundary, the whole line, the x-axis, part of the x-axis, positive x-axis, is turned into the next line. Okay, you keep turning it n times, you will come back to the real axis. Next example, which is little more interesting or little more complicated, is start with a two-dimensional vector space R2, pick up any two vectors as basis for R2. Okay, any two vectors as basis for R2. Now you take the subgroup generated by these two vectors, abelian subgroup, not the vector space. They generate the vector space R2, but they take the subgroup generated by R2, that will be a free abelian group of rank 2. So I am writing here as L square. Namely, all elements which look like m times u plus n times v, where m and n are integers. Okay, so that happens to be a discrete subgroup. Okay, you can mark these things on starting with u and v, make a parallelogram. So you get 4 vertices of the parallelogram. Keep translating this parallelogram both up and down, right and left, and so on. So you get all those lattice points. Okay, so that is the subgroup. The quotient is now, is just the quotient of one of these parallelograms. Any one of the closed parallelogram is good enough to cover the entire thing. Okay, and the quotient is again a covering projection. Indeed, the quotient space is nothing but homeomorphic to S1 cross S1 again, just like if you have taken the U and V to be a special case as the, E1 and E2, two perpendicular vectors. Okay, the importance of this one is that no matter what your choice of U and V, that they must be independent, that's all. The quotient space is always S1 cross S1. S1 cross S1 in the sense of it's homeomorphic to the torus. But remember that R2 can be thought of as a complex plane with complex structure. Then there is a way to give complex structure to the torus, which will depend on what vectors for generating vectors you have taken. Indeed, it will depend upon just angle. Depending on the angle, choice of the angle, you will get different complex structures on the torus. They are all called elliptic curves. In fact, they are all smooth elliptic curves. They are all of them smooth elliptic. This is a very classical subject and extremely important in other areas of mathematics also, like this was used in solving Fermat last theorem also. And this is classical in sense, it goes back to Weierstrass and even Abel and so on. The study of the elliptic curves. And it goes back to Riemann also. And you know, these are examples of Riemann surfaces, not the first one. The first one is a sphere. The next set of examples, the simplest examples are these tori, okay, with a complex structure. So beyond that, I cannot touch this one. This may be just a motivation to study these things, because the study of elliptic curves itself is a very, very, very deep subject. One can study the whole thing for the entire of one's life. But we can now, from S1 to S1 cross S1, we generalize. We can immediately generalize it to all dimension, S1 cross S1 cross S1. All that you have to do is take n vectors in Rn as a basis vectors, any basis vector. That will give you a subgroup of Rn, which is of, you know, abelian subgroup, which is of rank n. That will be a discrete subgroup. The quotient will be, again, a compact space, and that is nothing but S1 cross S1 cross S1. Okay. Now, what will be the fundamental domain here? Once again, you look at the box given by all these zero, V1, V2, V3, V4, etc., your n vectors. And like a parallelogram, you generate the box, okay, parallelepiped. So that will become a fundamental domain. In dimension 3, it should be like a cube. If you take vectors to be perpendicular, then it will be a cube. The more familiar example, which you have studied already, is projective space. Projective space we have defined first as quotient of Rn minus 0. Okay, but then you can choose S2 such that the projection from S2 to that one is also surjection. Now, even S2 is not a fundamental domain, because there are points interior which may be related. So all that you have to do is cut it down in half, take only the upper hemisphere, then the interior, there is no identification. On the boundary, x going to minus x is still identified. That is allowed. So this was used in understanding the projective space inductively, right? I have discussed this one earlier. For example, in the case of n equal to 1, this will immediately tell you that the projective space P1 is again homeomorphic to S1. Because then the fundamental domain is just an arc, the upper hemicircle, and 1 and minus 1 are identified. So when you identify a string, the endpoints are identified by a single point, what you get is circle. Okay. And that will give you picture of S1, and it will also give you a picture for P2. P2 is now nothing but a disk being attached to the circle. Why is Z going to Z square? Namely, 1 and minus 1 on the boundary are identified. So that is the picture of Pn. Unfortunately, it is easy to describe that, but you can't construct a model within remaining inside R3, because P2 is not in middle in R3. The next example is of more interest to topologists. It's called Klein bottle. It's again two-dimensional thing. So I will explain this one, because it seems that many people have a wrong conception of what is Klein bottle. (Clears throat) Okay, consider the subgroup G of rigid motions in R2. What is a rigid motion? Which preserves the distance in R2. Okay, translations, rotations, and such things. The rigid motions in R2 generated by following two elements. One is just a translation along the x-axis. X goes to x plus 1, y remains the same. The second one, the first variable is reflected in the line, in the point 1 by 2. So it's x goes to 1 minus x. The second coordinate shifts, y goes to y plus half. So this is called a glide reflection, gliding along the y-axis, reflecting along the x-axis, but not exactly x-axis, but here, x equal to 1 by 2. Okay, so such things are called glide reflections in complex analysis. All right, it's a rigid motion. It can be thought of as two, composite of two things, namely one reflection and then translation. Okay, reflection is also a rigid motion after all. Only thing is it is not orientation preserving. So such thing is a glide reflection. So look at just square of this, r square of this, 1 minus x, 1 minus 1 minus x is x, y plus half will be y plus 1, so which will become a translation along the y-axis. Hence, if you take t is translation along the x-axis, r2 square along the y-axis, that will be just like your standard Z2 inside R2, okay, generated by 1 comma 1, right, as basis, I mean E1 and E2, that is what it is. You generate a free abelian group of rank 2 in R2, which we have studied above. The quotient would have been S1 cross S1. But now I am going to take the subgroup generated by T and R. T and R square will be a subgroup of that. So now I am going to quotient R2 by a larger group. Okay. A larger group, a group which is the Z2 happens to be a subgroup of index 2 inside that. Okay. So it follows that H is a subgroup of index 2 in this G. H is Z direction, sorry. Check that the action of G on R2 is E1. Okay. So this is fairly easy. All that you have to do is take the neighborhood of any point, say 0, 0, for example, and take small enough neighborhood, very small enough neighborhood, such that either reflection or shifting does not intersect with each other. That's all. Okay, so details I will leave to you. So check that the action is indeed, I have written already. So you get 0, 1 cross 0, half is a fundamental domain. Okay, so rectangle of length 1 and half along the y-axis. So that will give you a fundamental domain for this action. Okay. So here is a fundamental domain for this one. This is a fundamental domain for the torus action. This is for what we are going to get, a Klein bottom. Okay. The identification, look at here. X-axis is shifted. Okay. Along the y-axis, what happens when you go shifted? Anyway, this is torus action, that's clear. Namely, this way I shift, this way I shift. Okay, so x-axis is shifting like this, y-axis goes this way. Okay, halfway through, you are rotating this way. So, what you have to do is, when you come here, this will be 1 minus x. See, this is half, half will go to half. But 0 would have gone to 1. Okay. So say one by one third would have gone to two third and so on. It's coming this way. So that is why I am coming this way, and I am going this way, I am coming this way. Of course, remaining here, it would have been different. But I am shifting also, right? So a point here would have gone to point here. And point here would have gone to point here. On the line y equal x equal half, this will be just shifting from here to here. Okay? So the action is like this. And this is shifted like this. So identification is precisely this line segment is identified, this one, after rotating, not just like that. This one is identified as it is. You can perform this one first, then you get a cylinder. While you perform identifying this one, you can't just bend it down and glue it like this. You have to bend it and go inside and glue it like this. And that is why you cannot perform this one remaining inside R3. So this is a Klein bottle. Okay. One knows that the Klein bottle cannot be embedded in R3. You will learn this in an advanced algebraic topology course. That it cannot be embedded in R3 is not a part of this course. You can't handle that one. Putting theta equal 2 pi t psi, 2 pi s, consider f from R2 to R4. In for R4, I am giving you a embedding. Of R2, I am defining R2 to R4, this map. It is of, see, there is a 2 pi t, there must be a comma here, psi equal to 2 pi s. I am put theta equal to 2 pi t, psi equal to 2 pi s. Okay. Then f of t s is 2 plus cos theta, which means 2 plus cos 2 pi t. Writing 2 pi, etc. becomes too big, that's why I have written put that one. And then cos 2 psi, that means if s is replaced by 2 pi of that, which will be 4 pi s. Okay, so write like this, you take sin theta, cos theta, and so on. What you get is, in theta, it is of period 2 pi, okay, and in psi, it is a period of 4 pi. Okay, so you will get a action, you will get a map which respects the torus, which respects the action of T and G here, the group G, whatever I have written down here. So it goes down quotient and defines a quotient from the Klein bottle inside R4. That map, you have to show that it's injective. Okay. Once you show that it is injective, that's enough, because one can show that the quotient is already a covering projection and quotient is a compact space. This is a Hausdorff space, so automatically it will be embedded. Okay. So this is elementary checking, but many people make mistakes here. Okay, elementary mistakes. So I have written down this one. So please check that I have not made a mistake. That's all. Okay, rest of the thing that I have put here, we will discuss it some other time. They are all counter examples here. So they don't play much role in the theory that we are developing, but they are good for understanding what is going on. So we will cover it in some other time. Thank you.